God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And then Jesus responds, you have answered correctly, do this and you will live. Now, did he say you'll have eternal life? I don't want to get too far down that road, but he is pointing out the path of life. This man had succinctly put it down. He got it. Then he does a very fallen human thing. The lawyer responds, but wishing to justify himself. How many of you did not justify yourself last week to anybody? Woo, baby, don't we do it all the time? Wishing to justify himself, he said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? And of course, then we have the story of the Good Samaritan, which is an oxymoron, because to the Jews, was there any such a thing as a Good Samaritan? No. That's supplied language. That's not in the text. You won't find Good Samaritan there. But the important thing here is that Jesus, gives him the story, and then in verse 36, 10:36, he says this. Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell into the robber's hands? Who's asking the question? Jesus is. And what's the man's response? The one who showed mercy toward him. Jesus' response comes in a form of a statement. Go and do the same. So Jesus is really, what he's coming back to here is, this is kind of the fundamental question that Jesus asks, I really believe he asks, is that how stands it written? How is it written? What has God said? So that's where the fundamental question is. It comes back to, what has God said? Has he said anything, or has he just kind of like said nothing and we got to figure this out on our own? He said plenty. All we need to know for living life, God has already told us. I believe that. Now, making sense of it in the clutter and the chaos of the days and weeks that we live in sometimes, it doesn't seem like that. That's why we have to remind ourselves where we go back to get some ground to stand on when our world shakes. What is written? How does it read to you? Really important. Proverbs 28:10, I was doing my devotions this morning and came upon this in Proverbs 28:10. This is out of the NIV. He who trusts in himself is a fool, but he who walks in wisdom is kept safe. And I'm just going to put something in here real quick. If you don't have time to spend with God each day, you don't have time to watch CNN, CBS, NBC, Fox News, you don't have time for that either. Now, I'm being a little sharp here. You've got time to meet with God every day, believer. You do. Are you making the time, or are you being a fool and you're trusting yourself? But he who walks in wisdom is safe. Now, that safety doesn't mean bad things don't happen. Believe me, I can tell you. But it does mean that God has spoken to us. How it is written, how does it read to you? Are you putting yourself in a place where you can listen to God? So I'm just going to do three other questions this morning and take you to some of those places where I believe they are aptly said. First one is in John chapter 5. John chapter 5. So the first one is actually, there's four questions today, is how does it read? How does it read to you? Where is it written? How does it read to you? So that's the first one. The second one that Jesus asks, and he asks a lot of questions. If you take your New Testaments, if you take your Bibles and you start to, if you're a marker, find a special pen or something like that to put a mark around the question marks. Because it's got all kinds of question marks. It has all kinds of questions to Jesus and from Jesus. And those are really important because we love to have questions, don't we? No, we don't. We love to have answers. But you can't have an answer if you don't ask a question. Jesus put that in a different way. He says, you don't have because you don't ask. And then James picks up on that and says, you ask, all right. But you ask in such a way as to just keep your piggy bank big, so you don't have to depend on me. So the second question I want to bring you to is this one very simple question. Do you want to get well? How many of you know people that are not feeling really good or down and out or whatever, and they love it? I do. I know some people so comfortable in their illnesses and in their way that they don't want to get well. But interestingly here, Jesus comes, and let me just read here. This is John chapter 5. You can turn there if you'd like to. John chapter 5. I'm going to begin reading in, I'll just synopsize. The first verses are, he's in Jerusalem. He comes to the pool of Bethsaida. There's where all the multitude of those who were sick and lame would gather. Verses 3 and 4 are not in some of the earliest manuscripts, and I don't have enough time to go into that, but the idea is that they gathered in this place. This is a hospital or something like that. And so Jesus comes into this place, and he sees this man. Verse 5, a man was there who had been ill for 38 years. Now, I want to be really careful when I talk about this man, because I really don't know his condition. I don't know why, but I just know that it's stated here he has been ill for 38 years. So do you think he was a regular at the pool of Bethsaida? Yeah. When Jesus saw him laying there, he knew that he had already been a long time, and then my Bible supplies, in that condition. And then he said to him, do you wish to get well? To me, this is a fundamental ministry question in the church. There are a couple of really fundamental questions you have to ask in all ministry. Can you be honest? Tops the list. Will you be honest? And then shortly thereafter comes this one, do you want to get better? Do you want to get well? In this case here, the man's response tips it off a little bit, and some people take this stronger than I do, but he basically comes back, and he seems to identify with being sick for a long time. And so he says it this way. The sick man answered him, sir, I have no man to put me in the pool when the water is stirred up, but while I am coming, another steps down before me. There's nothing I can do about it. Some of you are dealing with things where I think you may be saying to yourself, there's nothing I can do about it. Now that can be done in such a way as to, we talked about, I surrender all. In other words, we give those things to God. But some of you, I think, are trapped. And you keep on saying, there's nothing I can do about it. I think you need to hear the Savior say to you, do you want to get well? Will you trust me? Because look what Jesus does next. In your Bibles, I don't have this up there projected. Another one comes down before me. I can't get there fast enough. I just can't do that. Do you want to get well? And he says, get up, pick up your pallet, and walk. And which really is fun for me, this is one of those places in Scripture. If you haven't walked for 38 years, this really tells me that this is a God thing, right? He gets up. No rehab. He gets up and he walks and he gets in trouble right away. The religious police see him doing something he's not supposed to do on the Sabbath day. Why are you doing this? Well, the man who healed me told me to get up and walk. Who is this man? And Jesus gets incognito and he walks away. He gets to make sure he isn't there. Interestingly, though, this is what happens next with this man. Do you want to get well? Jesus says to him. Heals him. Verse 14. Afterward, Jesus found him in the temple. So the man had made his way to the temple outside from the pool of Bethsaida. Said to him, behold, you have become well. Watch this. Do not sin anymore, so that nothing worse happens to you. Now there's a doctor follow-up. Right? See, sometimes I want to be careful I say this. Some of us enjoy our sin. We don't like the results of what happens when we practice our sin, but we enjoy it. Whether it be gossip, whether it be worry, whatever it may be, we kind of we get used to it. And Jesus comes to us and says, you are crippled. Do you want to get well? So he follows up this man with this very simple statement. Okay? Don't sin anymore. Now, we all like to say, well, we're all sinners, and you know, I can't help it. You know what? Why would Paul write something like he does in Ephesians chapter 4 then? He begins this little section that you're going to see up here. He says this, so that I say and affirm together with the Lord that you walk no longer just as the Gentiles also walk in the futility of their mind, being darkened in their understanding, excluded from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them because of the hardness of their heart. Then he goes on and he says this, and having become callous, having given themselves over to sensuality for the practice of every kind of impurity of greediness, you did not learn Christ in this way. Indeed, you have heard him, you have been taught in him, just as truth is in Jesus, that in reference to your former manner of life, you lay aside the old self, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lusts of deceit, and that you be renewed in the spirit of your mind and put on the new self, which is in the likeness of God, has been created in righteousness, holiness of the truth. My goal for me as a pastor with you guys out there is that Christ is formed in you. I hope that's the goal of every pastor in an evangelical church, that Christ is formed inside those who come and call that home church. The Christ-likeness, so that when you go out into our community, you are Jesus Christ is in you and living through you with the people around you. You can't want to get healed and then go back and want to live in the crud again. You've got to at least have the desire to put off the crud. And I think that's what Jesus was talking about with this man. I wasn't that bad. John chapter 5 is one of the most succinct salvation verses that there is. In John chapter 5, verse 24, truly, truly, I say to you, he who hears my word, believes him who sent me, has eternal life, and does not come into judgment, is passed out of death into life. It doesn't get much more simple. The gospel doesn't get much more simple in a statement than that. But the good news is the news to be lived out again. That's why if you don't have time for the good news, you don't have time for Fox. If you don't have time for the good news, you don't have time for the world news. Let the good news be first. Then let the world news in so you can filter it. Right? I could go on. Second question that I want to bring before you. Why are you afraid? Matthew chapter 8. These are familiar stories for you who know the Bible and been around church for a while. These are very familiar stories, but I want to again emphasize the idea that Jesus is asking questions. He's the one that asks the most important questions. So let's take a look in Matthew chapter 8. I'm going to begin reading. Let's see, where will I begin reading? I'm going to begin reading in verse 23. Here's what we read. So he's escaping the crowds. He's getting away. Jesus saw a crowd around him. Verse 18, he gave orders to depart to the other side of the sea. I get that sometimes, don't you? Let's get out of here. Scribes came to him, teacher, I'll follow you wherever you go. And he goes on and he talks about, no, you won't. Lord, permit me first to bury my father. Follow me and allow the dead to bury their own dead. It seems really harsh, but it's the idea of priorities. But it's actually really, it's about the idea of following, because that's where we pick up in verse 23. When he, Jesus, got into the boat, his disciples followed him. It's a contrast to these other two who were trying to set things up in a way that kept them so that they could have a little bit of control over their life. In contrast, Jesus got in the boat. What did his disciples do? They got in the boat. So they went wherever he went. And the interesting thing is, as we read the scriptures, we understand that it wasn't just always the 12. Now, sometimes it designates the 12. Sometimes it designates three of the 12. But Jesus actually took along a lot of people with him. So it wasn't just one boat, probably. It was a bunch of boats. So they saw Jesus get in a boat. They got in the boat. Some people said, hey, let's go. That's what kids used to do in high school. You know, if one got in a car and went somewhere, what did the other kids do? Hey, that's a great idea. Let's go. And all they follow along. Well, discipleship really comes down to, will you follow him? Will you go where he goes? Will you be in his presence? So I love this next thing. He says, gets in the boat, his disciples follow him. Behold, there arose a great storm in the sea, so that the boat was being covered with waves, but Jesus himself was asleep. Now, I would love to have that kind of sleep pattern. I've not been sleeping well. Some of you I know from stories, you haven't been sleeping well either. And this isn't a remedy for sleep, but might be, I don't know. What are you afraid of? And Jesus is going to get there with these guys. They came to him. How far did they have to go? I love that. They came to him. He's over there. This boat is probably not bigger, longer than this platform up here. It's about this, you know, it's about this deep, you know, goal, you know, what do they call that? You mariners, what do you call that? What's draft was only about like this, and then what's that, what's the side of the boat called? Bulkhead or whatever, I don't know. Doesn't matter, the hull, whatever. He's not that far away. Now, how would you wake him up? Did you wake him up like that? They didn't. What'd they do? Don't you know? Can't you see? Save us, Lord. We are perishing. Now, I have never been out in Lake Superior when it gets really bad. I'm sure some of you have. And at that moment, you recognize how close you are to having things happen to you that you don't want to have happen to you. It happens. But here we see this, and this is intended for us. It wasn't just for them. It's intended for us right now, today. They wake him up. First thing out of his mouth is, why are you afraid? Actually, literally, I think it is, why are you a-shaking? Why are you a-shaking? What's going on? You just woke me up. It's a little storm, nothing big deal. Then he got up and rebuked the winds and the sea, and it became perfectly calm. Now, I'm reading this as it reads. How stands it written? I believe this. I believe this is eyewitness accounts. So when Jesus said to the seas, to the storm, peace be still, it wasn't a gradual coming down. Now, things had to settle out, but it was like that. And so their response is a lot of fun too, because they are amazed. But before he gets to the amazed part, he does this. Why are you afraid? Because he's not done with his question yet. That's not the question necessarily completely. Why are you afraid, you men of little faith? Little faith. Five times it happens in Matthew. I think it happens, there's an account in Luke's gospel, it uses it once. It describes, and this is interesting, it describes somebody who is dull of hearing. So could they hear the waves and the wind? Oh, absolutely. What couldn't they hear? Let's go to the other side. Now, some of you have heard this story before. I'm not giving you anything new here. I'm reminding some of you of this story. Jesus said, let's go to the other side. He had told them what they were going to do. A storm is not going to stop them. They're going to get there. The Lord's voice, you know, so in other words, it seems like they maybe had a disinterest. This of little faith carries the idea of a disinterest, not really wanting to participate, not really wanting to bring it all in. It's kind of like a healthy disinterest. You know, I can hear you. It's kind of, okay, that sounds really good. But you're not really interested. That's kind of what this little faith is. Hearing, but really not really paying attention. Some of you probably have already checked out on me this morning, right? A little interest. The idea is, God said something. Do you believe it? Will you trust it? That's the fun, that's another one of the follow-up questions here. Because what we have here is a classic place where we see a lesson in circumstances that aren't the ones that we want. How many of you always get the same, you wake up every morning, Mr. Rogers and you are best of buddies. Everything is going great. I don't know who you are. But I can say to me and I can say to you is that circumstances do not determine who we are. In Christ Jesus, we are His. He determines who I am and what I have. But you have to ask yourself, are my legs a-shaking? My legs a-shaking. The best thing to do then at that point in time is recall something like we have where the writer of Hebrews says this. Make sure your character is free from the love of money, being content with what you have, for He Himself has said, I will never desert you, nor will I ever forsake you. So that we confidently say, the Lord is my helper, I will not be afraid, what can man do to me? See, again, I remember from last week, I am dust. Psalm 90 says, I'm dust. Yet I am dust that's loved by God. He knows me. He knows you. Why are you afraid? A second question he asks. A third one comes to this one. This is in Mark chapter 8. Some of Jesus' best questions come after he's dealt with the knuckleheads, the Pharisees. Now, I want to be really careful there too, because I'll tell you what, we live in a day and age of a bunch of knuckleheads. And it's easy for me to be a knucklehead. I cross into Phariseeism without even thinking some days. I cross into that where it's me, it's up to me, it's up to my ability to keep the law, to do these things, to make sure I've got it all right, to make sure everything's in just in order. And Jesus invites me to keep coming back and just to hang with Him and trust Him in my mess. Not just get your mess cleaned up, Keith, and then come talk to me. He invites me to be with Him in my mess. I hope some of you understand that today, that He knows about your mess and He's not scared of it. You may be scared of it, but He's not scared of it. So He invites you to come to Him and listen to Him. Mark chapter 8, we read again, another boat journey. This is fun. Good things happen in boats, I guess. I should get one. Verse 11, the Pharisees came out and began to argue with Him, seeking from Him a sign from heaven to test Him. Sighing, I love this portion. Sighing deeply in His spirit, He said, why does this generation seek for a sign? I have found myself in the last month sighing a lot. I suppose it's part of grief. I've just noticed that I'll be walking around and I'll just go, oh. And it's something deep. It doesn't have really good words to put with it. But this is one of those places where Jesus is dealing with these Pharisees, and it's like He just goes, oh. And in other places is, oh Lord, how long will I have to put up with y'all? And that's not in a mean-spirited way. It's just this deep desire that He has for people to understand Him and see Him. And so He has fed the 4,000. That's what we see above this section here. It says, then He gets in, verse 13, leaving them, He again embarked and went away to the other side. So this is the boat. So He and His disciples are in the boat. They're doing what they're supposed to. They have gotten in the boat with Him. They're following Him. But this is what Mark says in his gospel. They had forgotten to take bread and did not have more than one loaf in the boat with them. That's just like not planning for vacation right? One loaf, all these people. I bet you a couple of disciples start to realize, oh shoot, did you get it? No, I didn't. You get it? No, I didn't get it. One loaf. And He was giving orders to them, saying, now that's an interesting word right there. Can God give you orders? Can he? Think about it. Don't answer too fast, because he has. He goes here. He gave orders to them, saying, watch out. Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the leaven of Herod. Interesting that he puts Herod in there. I get the Pharisees are the religious people of the day. Herod is the civil authority in that area. Of course, then he's underneath the Romans and that kind of thing. But it's interesting that he talks about this, the leaven of Pharisees and the leaven of Herod. And he goes on. We'll come back to that here in a second. Hopefully I come back. They began to discuss with one another the fact that they had no bread. I'm like that. I'm sometimes, I think you're like that. You read this, and think you got it, but you missed it. I missed it. Well, he's patient with us. He's patient with them. But this is how he exercises this moment with them. I think this is really interesting. Because he goes and he asks them six rapid-fire questions. Jesus aware of this? Was he aware that they had no bread? Does the physical bread really, is that really what he's thinking about? No, it's not what he's thinking about. He knows that his disciples are confused, that they've got it crossed over what they're supposed to be thinking about. Aware of this, said to them, why do you discuss the fact that you have no bread? Question one, do you not yet see or understand? Two, do you have a hardened heart? Three, do you not remember when I broke the five loaves for the 5,000 and how many baskets full of pieces you picked up? It's four. They said to him, 12. Good, they did remember. When I broke the seven for the 4,000, how many large baskets full of broken pieces did you pick up? Seven. That's another question that he's just asked them. And then he ends with this. He would say to them, do you not yet understand? Question. I like this because when they got into the boat with one loaf of bread, they actually were sitting in the boat with the biggest loaf of bread the world's ever had. The bread of life was right in their midst. I'm going to say something to you, and I think it's true. The bread of life is here too today. Are you partaking of that bread, the Lord Jesus Christ? Is he your Savior? Do you know him? Are you walking with him? Have you trusted him? He's here. And I'd say it this way, he's tasty. And you can trust him. But these rapid fire questions, when he says this, I love this question, verse 21, do you not yet understand? This word carries with it the idea, are you not making the connections? Understanding is making the connections. How many of you know not to touch a hot stove? How many of you are dumb enough to touch one to know you shouldn't touch a hot stove? Don't answer that question. Understanding is making the connections. Did you see what he did in those rapid fire questions to the disciples? They were arguing about, did you bring the bread? I didn't bring the bread. Did you bring the bread? I didn't bring the bread. We don't have any bread. We only got one loaf. And Jesus uses this opportunity to say, I want you to be aware of something else. Don't get involved with the bread, the leaven, the stuff of the Pharisees and the world system around you. You've got something much better to subsist on. Me. But he did it in such a way as he gave them these rapid fire questions to help them start making connections. When I did this with 4,000, how many did you pick up? Oh, yeah. When I did it with 5,000, how many baskets did you pick up? Oh, yeah. Do you think they started making the connection? Yeah. That's what we're supposed to do too. So when Jesus says, do you not understand who I am, if you put it that way, make the connections. Because it's right there. It's right there. Psalm 103, verses 13 and 14, we read these things here. Just as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he himself knows our frame. He's mindful that we are but dust. Yet he loves the dust. He loves us. And it is his desire, I can honestly say this, his desire that when he asks you questions, he's not trying to trick you up, not trying to make it harder. He's trying to open your heart up to him. That he is the answer to the deepest parts of your questions in your life. Jesus Christ is. He is the answer to your questions. So every day is full of questions. And I'm just asking you again, who do you let ask the biggest questions of your life? And I say to you, Jesus Christ does. Are you willing? Maybe I'm beating this horse too much. I don't care. There's an old preacher had this thing. How many of you know Psalm 23? All right, good. Everybody knows Psalm 23, right? The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. But this old pastor one time says, you need to read that like sheep, not like goats. And this is what he said. You got to read that like sheep. The Lord is my shepherd. If you're a goat, this is how a goat does it. The Lord is my shepherd, but. How many of you use a lot of buts with God? I want to encourage you. I'm not beating you with that. I'm not trying to beat you. I'm just trying to introduce something to you. How many times do you say but to God? You said this, but. We need to be sheep with him, not goats. Father, today I come and I thank you for those who sit here this day. I thank you for Chris in Thailand. Blessings on him, Lord. And Lord, may we be willing to open ourselves up to you and not be afraid. And that we can trust you. May your mercies come upon us who need a lot of mercy. May your grace shine upon us who have nothing to offer in return for the gifts that you give when all you ask is, trust me. Thank you for your love for us. Lord, many of us are not free in that love yet. We still are fighting it. I pray we would stop fighting your love for us and just turn ourselves over to you and look to you that we may be well. Lord, I ask your mercies on this gathering called Grace Bible Fellowship, that we may be a church, a gathering of your people that is honest and open, that wants to be healed, wants to be part of people's healing, takes you at your word, walks in it, and we do it together. We love you. We thank you that you've loved us with an everlasting love. It's all over the scriptures, Lord. Help us to see it. For I pray these things in the one and only and truly wonderful name of Jesus Christ. Amen.